So the talk, the title for this series of lectures is Arithmeticity of Discrete Groups. And this talk is a historical survey. So I will begin this first talk by giving a survey with no proof. So at the end of this lecture, maybe we will not be happy because we will have zero proof. But the second hour, I will focus on an example and with complete proof. So this example will be 4x4 matrices, SL4. And so maybe at that time, you will regret the first talk where there is no proof. But so let's begin with this part. And so I plan to discuss arithmetic groups. Arithmetic groups are a very important family of example of groups, which were important motivation as example for doing a geometric group theory, because they are, in some sense, complicated groups. They are very natural from the arithmetic point of view. And in fact, they look complicated at first glance, but in fact, they are not complicated. Because they look very much like their corresponding Riemannian symmetric space from the geometric group point of view. So this was really one of the motivation that maybe one can study complicated groups through geometry. So I will begin by 5 examples. So 5 examples of arithmetic groups. The first one is not really an example. Maybe I write it. Where? Okay. Is the fact that the group gamma. So those are examples. They're more of lattices. It's the group ZD. Is lattice in the group RD. So what does this mean? You can draw, for instance, Z2 inside R2. So it's a group of translation by integer coordinates. And when you do this translation by integral coordinates, you have a fundamental domain, which is here. And this fundamental domain has a finite volume in RD. So this is the definition I will choose for lattice. This means that gamma is a discrete subgroup meaning the point of gamma in G are isolated and of finite covolume. So this means that I'm able to find a fundamental domain, F in G, whose translated by gamma cover RD. And this domain, F, has finite volume. Here is a finite volume for the Lebesgue measure in RD, but in general, it will be for the R measure. OK, so this is my the definition of lattice. And here, it's more than finite volume, in fact. It's compact. So we'll say that it is a co-compact lattice. So the second example will explain why I have not chosen the definition of having a compact fundamental domain. Is the fact that the group gamma, and which is SLDZ, so the D times D matrices with integer coefficient, is a lattice in the group G, which is SLDR. So I want to maybe explain more. I will give no proof, but maybe give a picture for this fact that it is a lattice for the case where D is equal to 2. So, and I want to draw you a fundamental domain of finite volume for SL2Z in SL2R. And so what you do is that to represent SL2R, you represent it as the unit tangent bundle to the hyperbolic plane. So in the upper half space model, a point in G is a point here, and a unit tangent vector. And so this upper half plane, you have 0, 1, minus 1, and so I've just drawn the upper half plane. And you have a coordinate system where you have complex number z equal x plus y, and this angle is theta. So each unit tangent vector has a coordinate you know it when you know x, y, and theta. This is a coordinate system. And the R measure in this coordinate system is very easy to compute. It's the measure for the hyperbolic metric, dx dy over y square, and then for the angle, you have d theta. So one knows that a fundamental domain for SL2Z is all this part. I leave it to you as an exercise if you have not seen it yet. It will play no role in the rest of the talk. And if you compute the volume of this with respect to this measure, so the integral in theta is finite, the integral in x is between minus 1/2 and 1/2. And the integral of y is between 0 to infinity, but there is a y square between 1 and infinity, but there is a y square down, which makes the integral converge. So it has finite volume. The fundamental domain has finite volume, so it is a lattice, but just in the sense of this definition, because this lattice, as you see, this fundamental domain is not compact, so it is a non-co-compact lattice. Okay, so this example is due to Minkowski. In 1910, something like that, more than 100 years ago. But since then, many similar examples of groups that you can define in an arithmetic way, happens to be lattice in natural Lie groups. So, for instance, it was noticed that if you look at the group SLD Z square root of 2 is again non-co-compact lattice. In the group G. So, as you see, this group is not discrete because this square root of 2 is not discrete in R. It's dense in R. So, there is no way that you get a discrete subgroup in SLDR. But what you do, you think of Z of square root of 2 as being a subring of R in two ways. So, and you use these two ways to embed gamma in two copies of SLDR. One is just you don't change the G, the other one you apply Galois. Meaning when you have the sum of two matrices A and B having an integer coefficient, its image by this Galois conjugation will be A minus B square root of 2. So this is the second example of lattice. And the second example of arithmetic lattice. Now, you can try to develop this idea to other groups, like orthogonal groups. So this was done by Ziegel in the 30s, 40s. Is the fact that if you take the quadratic form Q, which is, I just choose one example. All quadratic form with integer coefficient will work. Let's take this example. This quadratic form, which is non-degenerate in D variable, but non-positive definite. And if you take the orthogonal matrices for this quadratic form, the matrices which preserve this quadratic form, but with integer coefficient, then this group is lattice in the orthogonal group with real coefficient. And this group is non-co-compact. So this tells you that there are many matrices with integer coefficient which preserve this quadratic form which has integer coefficient. So this is nice. You may wonder whether this group is a very nice group, in fact, because it's the group of isometry, because your quadratic form is a Lorentzian quadratic form. It's the group of isometry of the hyperbolic space of dimension d minus 1. So it's a d minus 1 dimensional analog of the hyperbolic plane. And in the hyperbolic plane, you have all these nice tilings, periodic tilings with a compact tile. Here we have an example with a non-compact tile, but there are also examples with compact tile that have been popularized by Escher. And you may wonder whether those do exist in any dimension. And here we have almost an answer of that, except that the tile is just finite volume. It's not a compact tile. But it's easy to get one which is compact if you do this trick, the trick of example 3. So this is the example 5, which tells you that if you take the quadratic form with a minus square root of 2, x1 square plus xd minus 1 square minus square root of 2 xd square, then the orthogonal group is co-compact lattice in so what you do is you do the same thing as here, meaning there is no reason that this group is discrete because it has coefficient in this ring, which is a dense ring. So the way you make it a discrete group is to embed it in the product G, which is the orthogonal group and then you want to you have to start with your element G and you want to send it to this couple G and its image by Galois. So you replace the square root of 2 by minus square root of 2 and it does not preserve anymore this quadratic form, but it preserves the image of Q by the Galois automorphism. So this G sigma belongs to the orthogonal group for Q sigma. Q sigma is just the quadratic form, but you have switched the minus square root of 2 in a plus square root of 2. And okay, so the fact is that this group is a lattice in this product. It's discrete because this square root of 2, when you look at it in R cross R by this double embedding, you get a discrete ring. But it happens to be in fact a lattice and a co-compact one. But what is nice in this construction is that this would be true for any quadratic form with coefficient in this square root of 2. But with this choice, where when you switch a sign, you become positive definite, this group here is compact. This group is compact. This means that this implies that if you remove it, meaning you project, you have a discrete group in this product, and if you forget about the compact part, it will still be discrete, and it will be still be a co-compact lattice. So with this construction, you get a co-compact lattice in SOQR, and so which is better than what you had here, because here we had a non-co-compact lattice. So meaning I can forget about this and I still have a co-compact lattice. Okay, so this gives you the example of a periodic tiling of the hyperbolic space with compact tiles. So historically it was an important example because you see this group from the arithmetic point of view looks natural. It looks complicated, and what this tells you is that this group is not very different, seen from far away, is not very different from the hyperbolic space of dimension d minus 1. And this hyperbolic space of dimension d minus 1 is one of the simplest geometric space you can imagine. So a lot of things are known about this group now because of that. Okay, so I have given an example of arithmetic groups. Are there questions?
For SOQZ, if you set D equals 3, is it isomorphic to SL2Z?
For D equal 3, this SOQZ, I guess, yes. Maybe up to finite index, I guess, yeah. Now, I don't know how to manage 3 is too much. Yes, I like huge blackboard and yeah. Okay, let me. So you suggest me I try here. Now I want to go to the part where I discuss general results. So. I will introduce definitions, maybe I will try to make them simple, but I have to tell you, if you don't get them, it's not that important, because later on I will discuss just SL4R, so 4 by 4 matrices. Okay. So. So the setting is that G is semi-simple real algebraic group. So this means, semi-simple means that it's Lie algebra, G is semi-simple. And I will just give the definition. Definition is, it has no abelian ideals. So it's just a definition, but the list of semi-simple Lie group is well known, and it contains example G is SLDR, G is a symplectic group. In 2D variables, or G is the orthogonal group for some non-degenerate quartic form. So all these very classical groups are in the list of some bisimple group, and you can do slightly more, replace R by complex number or by quaternion algebra. Okay, so this is the definition of semi-simple, and I also assume algebraic. So what is the definition? The definition is that, in fact, G, you can see it in as a group. I will just take a very basic definition, okay? I can see it as a group of matrices. For me, a real algebraic group will be a group of matrix for some n. And after, I will forget about the embedding. But this group G will be a subset of SLNR, a subgroup, but defined by polynomial equation. Like we have here, like the polynomial equation is to be of determinant 1, but maybe if you take n equal t, you have nothing. But or here, to preserve a quadratic form, this is a polynomial equation in the coefficient of the matrix. So is a subgroup and is defined by as the set of zeros of polynomials in the coefficient of the matrix. Polynomial equations. You have a family of polynomial equations with real coefficient. So this is the definition of a real algebraic group. Okay. So when you have all this list of examples, example 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, you want to know what is general about it. Is it a general theorem? And this is Borel-Aresh-Chandra theorem. Which tells you that if my semi-simple real algebraic group is defined over Q, so to be defined over Q means that this polynomial equation you can find the polynomial equation with rational coefficient. So like here, when you express that the determinant is 1, it's a polynomial, the coefficients are integer. When you express that you preserve a quadratic form, if this quadratic form has integer coefficient, it will be defined over Q. And so the theorem, the general theorem, is if G is defined over Q, then if you look at a gamma, which is GZ, that you define just as the element of G which are matrices in this embedding with integer coefficient is a lattice in G. So and I'm telling you that this generalizes all these examples, but maybe you may wonder, here I have the element of the group with integer coefficient, while here I have sometimes I take the coefficient not in Z, sometimes I take in Z, but sometimes I take in Z square root of 2. Okay? And so there is a trick that I already used implicitly, that in fact Z square root of 2 is made of integer. So this is this remark that that Z square root of 2 is just the set of matrices A, B, minus 2B, C, with A, B, sorry, minus 2B, with A, B in Z. So it's a ring of matrices. And so each time you have Z square root of 2, you replace by this matrix. So you get, instead of D cross D matrix, matrices, you get d cross 2d matrices, but in coefficient with z. So when you apply this theorem, you get all these examples. Okay, so this very nice theorem of Borel, Arend, Arish, Chandra. And what do we know about lattices?
Shouldn't it be plus 2b?
Sorry?
Shouldn't it be plus 2b?
Thank you. So then there is a Borel density theorem. Which tells you that if gamma included in G is a lattice, then gamma is Zariski dense in G. So I have to define Zariski dense. This means that it's dense for the Zariski topology, and if you don't know what the Zariski topology is, it means that for all polynomials P that are zero on gamma, they have to be zero on G. You take a polynomial in the coefficient of your matrices, you assume it's zero on gamma, and it will imply that it is zero on G. So this is a definition of Zariski dense, precise definition. Maybe it does not give you a lot of feelings. The feeling is that in between gamma and G, there is no algebraic groups. The smallest algebraic group containing gamma is G. But it's you need to make a proof of it. There is a trouble in this theorem, which is that when G is compact, assume G is compact, like the orthogonal group, then a lattice can be trivial. But a trivial group is not Zariski dense. So in all this, I assume that G has no compact factor. Not very important. I'm studying this setting when G is not compact or when it has no compact factor. So then the theorem is correct. So too far. So then you have seen that in some example, the lattice is co-compact, and in other examples, the lattice is not co-compact. So maybe we'd like to have a criterion. So this is a Cashdan-Margulis. For arithmetic groups, it is due to Goodman. So it's when you give yourself a lattice, maybe it's arithmetic, maybe it's some GZ, but maybe you don't know. And when is a gamma co-compact? And it is if and only if, except for the identity. In gamma, there are no unipotent elements. U. So, what is unipotent? This means that one is U is a. I'm dealing with an algebraic group, so U is a matrix. And unipotent element means that it just have one as an eigenvalue. So U minus 1 is nilpotent. To some power, it becomes 0. So this is the definition of unipotent. And you can one can check that it does not depend on the embedding. OK, so this is this co-compactness criterion. For instance, I don't know. Yeah. Maybe we can apply this to this example 5. In this example 5, we want to check that it is co-compact. So we just have to check that in this group, in this orthogonal group, there is no unipotent element. And the way you do it is that you notice that if an element is unipotent for this quadratic form, and it's imaged by Galois, this notion is invariant by Galois conjugation, this image by Galois will be unipotent. But then you get a unipotent element in a compact group, and it's easy to see that a unipotent element cannot be in a compact group, because in a compact group, elements are diagonalizable. So this is just a way to see that this criterion is really easy to check. But then Kajdan-Margulis pushed this idea of Kajdan-Margulis, and there is this nice theorem, nice improvement, which is the existence of cusp. And it tells you that if you have a lattice, so it's exactly the setting, the same, just an improvement of this one, and if gamma is not compact, so by this theorem, by Kajdan-Margulis, there exists some unipotent element. But in fact, what this improvement says, it tells you there are much more than one. It tells you that then there exists U inside G, an orospherical subgroup, such that gamma intersection U is co-compact in U. But I have to define what is orospherical. What is the orospherical subgroup? It will be a subgroup all of whose elements are unipotent. So the definition is that you can define it with one element of G. There exists at least one element G in G such that you can define U as the set of elements such that conjugation by G will collapse everything to the identity. It's the set of U in G such that the limit for n infinity of Gn U G minus n is the identity. Let me give you one example so that you... Example G is 4x4 matrices, and I have to tell you that now we are stuck with this group up to the end of this series of lecture. I will not speak anymore about semi-simple group, whatever, but just of SL4R and this particular unipotent. So, written as 2x2 block matrices. And I pretend that all spherical subgroups have this shape. For instance, for this one, how can I define this group this way? Choose the matrix G, which is 1/2 identity, a block matrix 0, 0, 2 times identity. And if you let G act by conjugation, if you compute, let me give you this this small computation. Like if you compute something like Gn A B C D G minus n. You can do the computation. You don't change A and D. And you multiply the C by 4 to the n. And the B by 4 to the minus n. So if you want this to go to the identity when n goes to infinity, this has to be 0, this has to be identity, this has to be identity. And this can be whatever you want. So this is an example of a orospherical subgroup. Now, the theorem I want to discuss in this series of lectures that I will use to explain many different classical results is the following theorem. With Sébastien Michel, which is converse. We have seen that if we start with an arithmetic group, there will be cusp, and it will be Zariski dance. And the converse is that if I have a discrete group for which there are cusps and which are Zariskidans, then they will be arithmetic. So this is what I plan to state. G be semi-simple. A real algebraic group, if you want. I don't write it, and but there is some assumption that the real rank of G is at least 2. And U is a orospherical subgroup. And the gamma in G is a discrete Zariskidans subgroup of G. Such that gamma intersection U. If I take the intersection of my discrete group with this orospherical subgroups, is co-compact in U. So I call it delta. This intersection is co-compact in U. So it's a lattice in U. Here means I have a discrete group of 4x4 matrices, which intersect this group of upper triangular matrices here as a lattice isomorphic to Z4, because this is four-dimensional here. And so those are the assumptions. And all these are satisfied by arithmetic groups. And the conclusion is that under the assumption, then gamma is arithmetic. Let me push this. Then gamma is arithmetic, is commensurable to some GZ for some Q form. Of G. So you see what happens is that when you have a group G, like the orthogonal group SOQR, this group is determined by Q up to equivalence of quadratic form modulo R. But there are many quadratic forms with integer coefficient which are equivalent over R but not over Z. So they give you very different group GZ. Okay, so this is the theorem I want to discuss now. Maybe I give the definition of the word which enters the theorem, like commensurable. This means that the intersection. Two groups are commensurable if their intersection has finite index both gamma and GZ. What did I forget to define? Is the real rank. I want to define the real rank here. That's the dimension of A. What is A? So I will just give a definition. And so it's a number. For SL4R, it will be 3. For SLDR, it will be D minus 1. It's the dimension of A. And A is a maximal abelian subalgebra of G, such that it's abelian, and all elements in the Lie algebra, the matrix, the adjoint matrix of X, bracket by X, is a linear transformation of G, which is diagonalizable over R. Is diagonalizable over R. So it's kind of complicated, but it's the A is a Lie algebra of what is called a maximal split torus of G. So that's the dimension of the maximal split torus.
Question.
Yes?
Would X as a map on the abelian subalgebra is diagonalizable?
Ad X is a map. Ad X is a map from G, the Lie algebra G to G, which sends Y to XY. That's the definition of the adjoint of X. So it's a linear transformation. And I want this map to be diagonalizable with real eigenvalues.
So this is should be true for all X in the maximal subalgebra?
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Okay, so I forgot to something. I have to assume that delta is co-compact in U and also irreducible. In G. Why do I need it? I need it because there is this higher rank assumption. So I don't want G to be rank 1. But if it happens that my situation is a product situation where you have G1 cross G2 and G1 is rank 1, I don't want my gamma to be inside G1 or a product, because it will be not correct on the left hand side. But I need this irreducible assumption, and let me tell you what it means. This means that delta intersection G prime is trivial for every normal subgroup of G. So if you have a proper normal subgroup, not G, not finite index in G, I want it not to intersect delta. If it intersects delta, you will be in a product situation. And this condition is automatic if you assume G to be simple. So this purple condition for SL4R, you don't have to check it. It's a simple group. Okay. So now I want to say the example I will discuss is SL4R. Okay. This is complicated. So let me say again this. I want to discuss this example. So the example with D equal SL4R. So starting from the next lecture, I will prove this theorem for this group SL4R and the U which is above. But before starting the proof, it's nice to see how many group gamma do I have to fight for? How many gamma does there exist? Do we have a kind of list of examples that will occur? So what are the question is what are the arithmetic groups of SL4R which intersect U as a lattice. So let me give you a few of them, which represent, I think, most of them. But the first example will be to choose gamma is SL4Z. You see SL4Z intersect, in this case, delta will be just this group of the subgroup of U, instead of B in M2R, you take B in the 2x2 matrices with coefficient in Z. So this is one example. But you have a different kind of example. One is not so complicated. It is gamma is SL2 of DZ. So DZ is a quaternion ring such that when you look at its real point, so it's like the quaternion, but the quaternion, when you look at them over R, it's a field. Here I choose the quaternion over the integer, but when I look over R, I want it to be M2 of R. So if you do that, you see that this DZ is a lattice in the 2x2 real matrices. And if you look at the 2x2 matrices with coefficient in DZ, according to Borel-Harish-Chandra, you get a lattice in SL2 of M2 of R, which is SL4R, and B, this will be my group delta. Delta will be B. Delta will be this DZ. Okay, and I finish with the last example, which is a very nice example. In the spirit of the five examples I have given at the beginning, using z square root of 2, what you do is you introduce a unitary group. So you might be familiar with unitary group. So SU, let's say SU 4 over z square root of 2, it's kind, this notation is kind of abusive notation. I will give the precise definition. What is the unitary group over z square root of 2? This means that here it's a set of 4x4 matrices with coefficient in z square root of 2 in the same way as if you want to define the group SU4 of C, of the complex number, how do we define the unitary group of the complex number? You take the 4x4 matrices with complex coefficient, and you say that they are anti-Hermitian. But for that, you use the complex conjugation. Here, instead, I will use the Galois conjugation by z square root of 2. So those are the matrices such that if I compute G, J, so transpose of G sigma, I will get J. And I have not written identity for J, I have written J because I want the group U to be exactly this one. So if you want U to be exactly this one, you have to choose just the anti-diagonal matrix. Okay. So this is an example of group, which is an arithmetic lattice in SL4R, and it intersects you in a co-compact lattice. Okay, so these examples are in the exercise you will have to do at the end of the today and tomorrow. So I think I have finished for this first lecture.